Hey all, here are OS Reviews. In today's retro review, we are revisiting a device from 2010. And believe it or not, this was actually the second ever Android smartphone released on AT&T service and the first HTC phone that was on AT&T running on Android. So really early days. It's from a decade ago, and recently we did retro reviews on devices like the iPhone 4. This is around the same era, back when phones were still really pocketable and tiny, and has just a 3.2-inch display, which makes it look like a child next to our phablets that we've become accustomed to. But if you have smaller hands, something like this is nostalgic in a way where you can still reach all the corners using your thumb. Although it was the first HTC Android phone on AT&T, part of the reason was because AT&T was one of the slower carriers to adopt Android smartphones at the time, since they had more of an exclusive relationship with Apple and iPhones, including the first iPhone that was ever released was a contract exclusive on their network. With that being said, this is definitely still very much a retro phone, and in today's standards, it's not something that most folks will be comfortable with using anymore, aside from just making occasional phone calls and whatnot. In terms of the hardware specifications, aside from the 3.2-inch display, it has a 5-megapixel camera on the rear. It has a utilitarian look to it, almost semi-rugged with these kind of screw accents, which really don't do anything since the back cover is removable. It's just for decorative purposes. Speaking of, if we pop off the back cover, we can see that the inside of this phone is actually accented yellow. It shows quite a bit of attention to detail from HTC's part. It used the Snapdragon S1 processor, however, it was underclocked to just 600 megahertz in this case. And as far as built-in memory, it came with just 512 megabytes, but it was expandable via the SD card slot that you saw behind the battery door. And in today's standards, they are not even as powerful as a super budget phone that would run on Android Go, for example, would have better specs. So really just a nostalgic look back more than anything. Now on the very top of the phone, we did still have a full-size headphone jack, volume controls on the side, and a micro USB port for charging on the base. Now this phone doesn't have a front-facing camera either, so it was before even video conferencing or selfies were really popular, and that just tells you how much has changed in the years since. But we did have capacitive keys down below for navigating Android. Going back home, there's a menu, a back, and a search key, and a relic of the past, an optical mouse or trackpad. More than anything carried over from the days of Windows Mobile and other UIs, which weren't as optimized to touch, but you can use this to slide between the various screens, and in some cases, if you're browsing the web, because the display here is pretty small, helps you select links a little bit more easily. The phone did come with HTC Sense UI on top of Android, which at the time was actually very welcome because Android was still in its infancy. Many features were not quite fleshed out, and Sense really was the best when it came to the UI UX experience, and after the success that the Taiwanese company had with Windows Mobile, it made sense for them to carry that interface style over. Different preset wallpapers, and Sense gave you different customization widgets, like that oversized clock that HTC popularized, as well as other things like Sleep View that you can pinch out to see all of your different home screens at once. So it really was quite a smooth and responsive experience considering the really low-powered CPU. For only 600 megahertz and a single-core chip, you can see that the navigation on the UI here is still surprisingly responsive for the most part. Running behind the scenes was Android version 2.1 Eclair, which is ancient by today's standards. There's definitely some elements of the phone that are still familiar. Things like the drag down notification shade are here, although you aren't able to access some of your shortcuts to controls from it. Scattered in the mix is also a handful of pretty useful HTC exclusives, like their clock and utility tools, which have a pretty nice consistent UI with the whole Sense interface. There's also an FM radio. Other services which were built from HTC included Footprints, which was a version of geotagging your photos. The animated weather app, which is a joy to see, just little subtle touches like that. One of the great ironies is that the display of the HTC Aria is actually still not shabby. Yes, the resolution and the pixel density is quite low. It's only 320 by 480p. Surprisingly, it is an IPS panel, which means that viewing angles are actually not that bad. Even if you look at it from various degrees and start tilting it, the colors themselves aren't washing out too much. This is a contrast with other HTC kind of budget phones that we've seen in newer years, such as the Desire 510, which has a regular TN display and the the viewing angles were atrocious on those budget devices. It's just so interesting to see that even on one of their earliest phones, the display quality was already pretty good. We can either take images or record video, and there's also some additional settings that we can adjust, like the exposure. There's also contrast, saturation, some different special effects that you can apply, as well as change the resolution. Some of these icons here do feel very nostalgic, and there's definitely some lag that you'll be starting to notice, but all in all, it is surprisingly still usable, and there is tap to focus at least. You can use the joystick to press down to capture a shot. There is no OIS of any kind, so you do have to hold quite still and be in good lighting conditions to get reasonable shots. It takes a moment sometimes for the images to snap into focus, but all in all, for a phone from 10 years ago, the camera is definitely still usable. That is despite lacking some finer details, since 5 megapixels isn't the most in the world, and some of the finer details are lost. Some other specialties of HTC Sense back in the day allowed you to create different profiles for various scenarios of how you use your phone. For example, you can change the different applications and wallpapers displayed if you're at work versus if you're at home, if you are traveling, all of those things will exhibit slightly different states. We can see that changing this to the alternative travel scene gives us a larger widget for the clock that can show off two different cities at once, our local one and the one that we're traveling to, and kind of clean up the apps which are displayed to focus more on things like email and productivity. The one for play gives us an oversized widget for the clock, which is pretty nice, and also gives us more things focused on web browsing as well as music listening with an oversized widget. But since the display really is so small, as you can see here, pretty much each page can only fit one widget, which is a little bit funny. You can actually long hold on the home key to bring up your previously used applications. This was the equivalent of multitasking, although with such limited RAM, the programs technically weren't open in the background. It just shows you a list of the last 6 apps that you were using. So we can jump back into them basically by pressing the home key. So that was slightly different in terms of the operation compared to newer phones. As for apps, a lot of these are very much out of date, including the browser, which does still open up certain pages, especially simpler ones, but anything that's more complicated will result in it crashing due to the low amount of memory and the fact that it's quite, again, outdated. You can try to install slightly newer versions of browsers by sideloading APK files or going to the App Store. However, not many of them are still supporting such a low version of Android anymore. This was the keyboard, by the way, which was actually quite usable, although it doesn't support anything like swipe. There is haptic feedback, though, so the phone does vibrate whenever you're tapping on it. It is, again, significantly slower than our modern phones to completely load the page, although the Wi-Fi signal strength is pretty decent. One of the good things of having a slightly underclocked processor and smaller screen, though, is the battery life is actually quite good. It can last me through, even today, a day or two's use before it needs to be recharged, and that's with connectivity options turned on, even though the technical cell size is only 1,200 milliamp hours, but for something so compact, it will get you through without any problems. Of course, other elements like making phone calls definitely still work, but it is a 3G phone, which is even these days starting to get a little bit phased out. That's more or less it for our revisited look back at the HTC Aria. It was, again, one of the earliest Android phones to hit AT&T's shores, and by that, it was a really compact, petite, and pretty cute phone. In another way, it's also a little bit unfortunate that HTC, once a pioneer in the Android and just mobile space, has since really faltered and no longer produces much phones at all. Although we hope that they can make a comeback, but it's just a little bit nostalgic and bittersweet to look back at something like this and just to see how much has changed in this space today. So anyways, you can check out more details in the links below. For now, that's been our video. That's been a nostalgic look back at the HTC Aria.